when I was standing here preparing my stuff, I heard some people giggling about JavaScript. So maybe this is now the moment to be honest. Who actually likes JavaScript? Quite a few. That's great. Who would consider themselves as a JavaScript hacker, like one who actually does JavaScript programming? That's maybe 30%. So I'm asking this not in order to like put the blame on you, but I have some JavaScript code examples, and I could show some fancy demos or some JavaScript code. Both of a little bit. So who would prefer some fancy demos? Like, okay, this is a few people. Who would like to see a lot of JavaScript code? Oh, that's at least a fair percentage of people who actually want to see a lot of JavaScript code. I don't know how big the intersection was. Like, but
I think the code had it. I think the code is.
Yeah? Okay, good. No, we will see. So when I prepared the talk, it was very hard, as you could see, well, until the last moment, what is my target audience? I had no idea. So what I prepared is something, it's almost a sales pitch, and I also had to sell this to myself, to be honest. And the sales pitch is about education, it's about development, it's about visualization, and it's about deployment. Of course, all in combination with machine learning. So, and I think all these four points have a valid case, actually. I wasn't so sure when I prepared the talk, but now I'm quite confident. But we will have to see together. So the slides are, as usually, it's JavaScript fueled, it's HTML, it's in the browser. This is the link to the slides. I posted this yesterday. MQT retweeted it. I will also tweet it after the talk. And my Twitter handle is DJ Korthose, which might be funny if you're German. And if you're not, then probably not. Okay, so first of all, you might ask, and totally reasonable ask, why at all? I mean, why would you even do this? I mean, why do you torture yourself? You can just use Python and you use R. Well, R, from my perspective, is also like the other side of the torture, but this is just me, personally. Because using those libraries, you have a large and mature set of libraries. It just works. You can Google it. It's on Stack Overflow. It's really fast because they all rely on some C++ code or even Fortran code if you need to. But they neatly hide it from you. But as soon as you let the old stuff run using JavaScript in the browser, you don't have that because all you have is JavaScript, right? So the rest of the talk is an answer to that question because I think that's a very reasonable question. So first, to educate either yourself or someone else. The good thing is there's no need for any sort of installation. You will see it when I click on the things, given the internet works and it looks good. You just need the browser and, as I said, the internet, which is quite nice. So the level to entry is pretty low because if you have that, all installation done. And then if you play around with things interactively, at least for me, I learn much easier. And this is also quite easy in the browser because it's all visual. So the first thing that I will demo in a few minutes is the TensorFlow Playground. Anyone ever heard of the TensorFlow Playground? Anyone ever played with a TensorFlow Playground? Okay, that's probably boring for you in the next 5 minutes. And it's about understanding neural networks, only like feed-forward networks, to be honest, but to play with them in order to understand them. And it's called TensorFlow Playground, but it's not really related to TensorFlow. It's also done by Google, but it doesn't use TensorFlow in the background. It uses a TypeScript implementation, like a naive TypeScript implementation of a network, like I would write it. So nothing too fancy. There's another thing that's really like very detailed, and you see a lot of numbers, and it's not easy to get started with it. But you see very accurate numbers. You see all the weights in a network. It's rather like, it's not a replacement for the TensorFlow Playground, but rather it adds to it. So I like this to actually see what's really going on, but it's much harder to grok and much harder to get started. But also very nice. And by the way, of course, if you just use that slide deck, you just click on the things and the example's open. I will show you. So very easy. There you go. So no need to take pictures or anything like this. And first demo, so this will be a couple of demos, as I said. The first demo is about that TensorFlow playground. And it actually works on all devices I could try it on, even on my mobile phone. So if you're bored in the train or you have your iPad with you, you can do it. And what can you see with the TensorFlow playground? You can actually see a lot, but you can especially see how training works, how a neuron works, and you can also learn about neural network architecture. So this is going to be a first demo. This is how it looks like when you start it, and I'm going to make it a little bit more simple. And I explain in a minute what I did. So the setup always is the same. You have a bunch of points, one yellow, one blue. They are somewhere on that two-dimensional plane. That means you have two input variables, like x1 and x2, they are named. And now what you want to do, you want to have a classifier that will tell you where would be a new blue dot that's not right here on the screen so far. So like that's a classification problem. And I think I should be able to show some test data. That means that is the data that is not used to train the network, but will be used later to show the accuracy of yet unknown data. So the task would be to predict where will be the dots that are not visible yet, but are visible now. And you do it by using this data and you train that network. And that network, well, it's just a single neuron. Just out of intuition, maybe someone was in the talk yesterday, will that network actually be able to like draw a line between those two classes? Will it be able to like separate the two from each other? I said line, I just noticed, so I spoiled it. But anyway, will it be? Who thinks it will be? Who thinks it will be able to? You're lying just to amuse me, of course. Now, I'm trying it, and what the simulator, what it does is it feeds in those data points, and it tries to optimize like the slope and then the offset of this line here to actually separate those two classes here. And as I already said, unfortunately, it's a line. And you can see that it's not possible to actually separate those two classes with just a single line, right? I could train it forever. And this thing up here is actually two lines, but you just see one. It's like the test loss and the training loss. Like, how well does this line separate those two classes? One is for the testing, what you see now. One is for the training thing that you see now, and one is for the testing. And they are both the same. I stop this now because it's hopeless. What would you say about this? I mean, what do you see here? Like in terms of machine learning, what do you see?
Too few layers.
Too few layers, maybe, but also maybe too few neurons. As I said, a neuron can like separate, can draw a line. So let's take a guess. How many lines will I need to actually separate those two classes from each other? Like okay-ish. Let's do four. At least four, I heard. Let's see. So what I'm doing, I'm adding those lines, and this thing is really super nice because you can see the weights when you just hover over those connections between neurons. And you see like what line it draws. So and if you just hover over one of those neurons, you will see just the effect of this specific neuron, which is really nice. So you see those four lines, and you see the combined, which is not good. But it's not good because I haven't trained it so far. So now I'm doing it. And whoever said four was quite good. Because again, you see both of those values going down almost in the same speed. That means the training that we did is very good. So we don't overfit. That means the training data doesn't do better than the test data. And we don't underfit, which means we actually are able to separate the two. and you can play around with it. As someone else said, we might need more layers, and you can do something like deep learning here. Well, calling it deep learning, well, technically it is. I'm adding layers, more hidden layers, and I can add more neurons. But because it might be a good idea to make the model as simple as possible, let's see. You see, it takes a lot of time, actually, to do, well, not so much time, but a little bit more. And you see, the solution is much, much more smooth. And maybe it's even a little bit better, but not by far. And if you look at the intermediate neurons, you see a lot of circles already in the middle. So that might be an indication that we can easily get rid of at least the last two layers. But if you want to ask, like, how many layers, how many neurons, you saw the intuition. Each neuron can sort of draw a line, and then we're out of intuitions, and the rest is like trying it out. That's nice. So we saw, how does a neuron sort of operate? It draws a line. How can you combine them? How do you train? And if you want to teach somebody something, show the same thing to someone, and then let them experiment. It's a lot of fun. And by the way, there are more examples, like more tricky ones, like this one. No, this one is tricky. That's really tough, but it's possible. Okay, so much for the TensorFlow playground. But there's more, still more on education, and I see I have to speed up. So who likes PCA or knows? No, who likes PCA? Who really understands PCA? Really? Okay, good, I need to talk to you later. I don't, but I understand the visual things, like you have many like dimensions, and then you reduce it to the most important dimensions. And if you're okay with explanations like this, then this visualization is like perfect for you or for people you try to explain. This works in 3D. You can like turn the whole thing, perfect stuff. I can't go into detail because of, I'm afraid that I can't show a lot of JavaScript code otherwise. PCA, tricky, but very powerful. And then again, I think I should ask the same question. Who understands TISNI? Aha, I need to put my hand down as well. TISNI is a way of visualizing like very high dimensional data in two dimensions, and then by doing it, grouping them in a way that's hopefully like putting data points in one area of the visualization that actually is connected to the other. I don't think anyone understands it. I'm yet to actually have to find someone. But this thing is great to experiment and at least try the very few parameters that you have and then get an intuition at least for it. I don't know why it works. Sometimes it has amazing effects, but well, sometimes it doesn't and then it just doesn't. Okay. I know it's, I have to be honest here. At least that's my impression of TISNI. It's super powerful. Try that out. Also, if you, for whatever reason, try to understand how optimization works, and it's all over machine learning. Like, if you train a neural network, you have most of the time stochastic gradient descent or some derivative of it. And if you want to like play around with it and get an intuition again, this tool is also, like this side is also perfect. This is, of course, again, interactive and like visual. And you see this ball moving down to one of the local minima here. And you can tweak the learn rate and do all kinds of other things here. It's also like super nice to try it out yourself or, again, teach it someone else. And when you say, why is it in the browser? Why is it at all? Why does it matter at all where it runs? Because it's highly interactive. And I've never seen it anywhere else. And it's totally accessible. You just send a link to someone, someone else clicks on it, tries it out, success. This thing here, I have talked about some people like how convolutional neural networks work. And yesterday, I think I said something like, it's like filtering, like the filters that you know from, maybe you know from Photoshop, but that's maybe too vague. And so this thing here is about like letting you try it out. And you may know that it works like this. Not quite sure if you see the, on the left side, you see the box, 3x3 box. Is it visible? And it works like this. So with the matrix in the middle, it lays over this 3x3 thing, or well, yes, sort of that. And then you compute a new value from it, and this is this value, right? So this stuff here, these are the values from the image. These are the values from a multiplication matrix, the kernel, and this is the result. And so you can move it over that picture with the filter you're seeing here, and then you see the result. I almost tried to ask what kind of filter is this, but it's right there. So, but you can see it. It's actually sharpening the whole thing. And why it works and how it works, it's not so important, because these parameters here, like the times 0, times minus 1, times 5, this is learned by the neural net. These are actually the parameters that you need to train it on. This is really nice. So this is a convolutional network, and we can do blur. I mean, the thing on the left side is already very blurring. Then we have Sobel, which is sort of like edge detection, and sort of does it, right? But the good thing is you don't need to like figure out which is the right filter here, but the filter matrix will be calculated or learned by your neural network once you're doing convolutional neural networks. Nice, right? At least for me, that makes it pretty clear like how it works and where the parameters come from that you need to train your network on. I like it. And again, I need to speed up, but I have so many like super cool examples. This is my favorite. I just like, not yesterday, but maybe on Sunday, I discovered this, but I had to do it. Hopefully it works. Okay, camera is on. Nice. First of all, this is zero installation. It's no OpenCV. It's no strange stuff. This is a very nice thing because it like uses all the cool features of the browser. This is completely written in something called DeepLearn.js, which I will show some code a little bit later. And you see, without installing anything, you can just use the features that the browser gives you, namely showing images, playing sound if you want to, and then making recordings using that camera. And then also the interactive part. That's super easy to get something done like this. But what is it about? So I can, probably you see that, yes. Every time I turn there, spoil it. So I can train the whole thing. Just me standing here. Random guy. Stop. Oh, no, stop. No, stop. Okay. So, and now trains again. Stop it, please. What did I do? Anyway, click somewhere else. Well, I keep on training it. Might be a bad idea. No, don't do it. I don't know. It doesn't seem to work properly. Maybe it's just my fat thumb here that keeps on re-triggering it. That doesn't look like a good exercise here. Oh, and it's... Anyway, so now I'm training this one. Maybe I can save it. And this is from this side. Maybe you can like stop training now. Well, this time it works. Good, good, good. So if it sees me from that side, it does that shaky dog. From this side, the cat. And now we need me did it from this side. I've never tried it like this, so maybe it doesn't work. So from this side, it should be like the third image. Trained enough. Still doesn't want to stop. Stop. No. But from this side, it shows the funny bunny. It's still thinking, I'm trying to train it. Okay, good, good, good. Perfect. No. Good. Okay, from this side, it should actually, well, I think I ruined it, right? I don't know. But you saw it sort of working, right? I mean, it sort of did work. So the idea is, even if you want to teach someone the whole thing as a game, maybe your kids or something, well, given that your thumbs aren't that thick than mine, then it should be able like to teach someone how does machine learning actually work. Now, as I said, obviously it crashed. You see? I'm very sorry. But you saw it working, yeah? Right? Are you satisfied? That was like my super demo. No, I spoiled it anyway. Close it. Is it on camera? Can we erase it? Anyway, so super nice. It's in the slide. Also, this thing here. Has anyone ever played that? Quick draw? Anyone? You have to play it. Also with kids. It's great. You need to draw something that the computer tells you to draw, and then it needs to guess. Like, it knows what it is, but then another part of the machine sort of doesn't know, and then that should be a cat, and it was seeing water. It's simply very good, but my drawing skills, maybe you know how my drawing skills are. This is my cat, it doesn't work. We will come back to the cat and this thing a little bit later. So the second thing will be development, like how do you develop with JavaScript? And the most obvious reason is you just like JavaScript, you want to develop with JavaScript, or you just have to develop for the browser. And then you maybe want to develop an application that involves a camera. Maybe you want to have an application that involves zero installation. So you just could be the reasons. So there's actually, if I were to name just one, it's DeepLearn.js. It's fairly new, but it's very easy to get started as someone who is a Python programmer, because the API is very close to NumPy. Do you call NumPy or NumPy? NumPy? Okay, good. Part of the API is very close to NumPy, and part of the API, another part, is very close to TensorFlow. So if you know how to build a TensorFlow graph, you instantly, like literally instantly, know how to build a DeepLearn.js graph and how you do like data processing with NumPy, except that JavaScript is a little more clunky in that way because you don't have operator overloading, so the syntax might be a little bit more verbose. There are other ways of actually using libraries for JavaScript. One of them, like the first, was ConfNet by Andrei Karpathy, which is, I think he's sort of like a star in that area. There's also Tisny library that allows you to integrate Tisny in your JavaScript application. And then there's Brain.js, like a naive implementation, but still very nice, Synaptic and ML. They are also nice, but I wouldn't use that for production. It's just for playing around. It's different for DeepLearn.js. And this is the bare minimum of JavaScript code I will torture you with. So on the left side, what you see is some sort of computation that you define, and that computation is supposed to look like similar to NumPy, or it should like do the same thing. What you can do here in line 10, is it big enough, by the way? Can you see it? Maybe we switch to my editor where it is bigger, like this. Better, right? So again, oh no, this time it is line 11. You define some sort of environment, like computation environment, and you will see in a second what it's good for. But the important part, and that might be also the exciting part, it contains the word GPU. And that all by itself is exciting, I would say. Because it indicates that this code might be running on my GPU, and it indeed does. My GPU is fairly, how should I put it politely? It's not a good one. It's not like high-end, but it has a GPU. It's not a good one, but it has one. And I tried it out. Maybe it's factor three. Factor three faster on my GPU. But the good thing, again, is if you use something like TensorFlow, then you're, as far as I know, you have to use the NVIDIA and the CUDA stuff. And with this thing, it works on a very cheesy GPU. So good stuff. It uses WebGL, if that tells you anything at all. So it actually does mean it works in any browser on any machine. Pretty cool. Like recent browser, not in the Explorer 9 or something. Like a real browser. Okay, I have a Windows machine, so I'm allowed to say that. So you create arrays. This is a one-dimensional array containing 1, 2, and 3. And you have a scalar here, which is just 2. This is just JavaScript. Imagine there's no const here, and it almost looks like Python. And imagine there's no new here. And then what you need to do, because the GPU is really not nice to program against, because you need to like take care of all the resources. So if you need some memory on the GPU, you tell it, I need it. But there's no garbage collection like that will notice I can free it again. So you have to do it yourself, which is unfortunate, but you have to do it like this. unfortunately. But if you use that mathematical scope here and tell it execute this code inside that scope, it keeps track of the stuff that you're using. Sometimes it can't, then you have to help it a little bit, and it clears up all the memory stuff after that. So this is the operation. You add A to B, and in that sense it would mean, let's see what it means. You can have a look somewhere here in the browser. I'm executing it. First, you see it runs in the browser, no installation. It doesn't have a shiny UI, as you can see. This is just the console, and it outputs 3, 4, and 5. And this is from line, it tells us 18. This is the actual recalled. It's here. So you get the results by calling get values. And that operation is defined that you add that scalar to each element in the array. Questions so far? No questions. Good, good. Just to give you an idea, because no one was like yawning so far, at least maybe because it's so bright, I can't see it. That's also fair. I will comment this in. That's the more exciting part of the code, but it's too long. I see it. I only have 20 minutes left. This thing here, if you're at all familiar or if you have at all seen TensorFlow, it's like defining TensorFlow graph with placeholders. That would be like a variable. And then you have arrays. And then you have, again, a variable. And then you define operations on those variables or placeholders. And then you stick it all together in a way. And if you follow the whole code, which obviously is too long, it can learn something. So you can train it by also supplying cost tensors by an optimization strategy. If you're familiar, just a tiny bit familiar with TensorFlow, it should feel very, very, very much the same. I'm just running it because it's too much code. I understand it. And you see the training thing, and the loss goes down to nothing at a certain point. And what it actually did, it had to find a multiplier matrix that you could use to, just to give you an idea what we actually did, that could use that could be used to transform this array to this, and this to that, and this to that. Not something that's very interesting, but at least it works, and it's running on the GPU, just to tell you. I haven't tried it on an NVIDIA GPU because I don't have one. Well, I have one, but only on AWS, and then there's no browser, and then, well. Anyone having a really powerful laptop with them? Something with a really good GPU, like a fat one? No, okay. I would have loved to like try it out later, but obviously not. But you could imagine it runs on a desktop machine. It might actually be fast. I haven't tried it. The Google people tell us, of course, yes, but why would I trust them on that? I would say the same, no matter what's the fact. Okay, I can't show more code. Give it a try. All that code, the code that I'm showing here, it's changed a little bit from the tutorials to just have it without any compilation run in the browser. But it's fairly readable. Also, the source code is fairly readable, and it's written in TypeScript. That means it's the typed version of JavaScript. It's a pretty decent language. If you want to do any development using machine learning in the browser, use this. Okay, 17 minutes. That's good. The third part, so the first one was you educate either yourself or someone else. Second part, you just really write the code. Well, a little bit different role. But now it's about visualization. And this could be, like, really you want to find something out about your data. And at least for me, it's often very helpful to interactively go through the data. And what I've found really, really helpful is, how's it called, data facets, I think. And I'm just showing it. What can you do with it? It's a little bit like pandas, I would say, but very visually. You can get an overview over your data. And you can load it up, upload it. I don't know what's a verb. I have some flight data. I uploaded it to the internet. Not to the internet, to my local browser. That's why it is so fast and it works. And you get some statistic information about it. Nothing too fancy, but I didn't tell it anything about my data. This is obviously about flight data and like their delay, where they're coming from and where they're going to. And you get freely something like standard deviations. Are there zeros in it? What's the maximum value? What is the what's the minimum value? And some things that really look fishy, it highlights it red. And I didn't have to do anything about it. You will see this is really interesting, departure delay. I know it's in minutes, 1,000 minutes of departure delay in that data set. Interesting. But this is just like bread and butter stuff. Like it's useful, but it's not shiny. But there's another thing, also provided by the same library. And it's called, give me a second. It's not called overview, it's called dive, because it lets you dive into your data. And I'm using a different data set here, and the data set that I'm using is the quick draw data set, where I was drawing the cat and the system tried to determine what it is. And this is like all the data that it has on all the drawings, and this is faces. Like it collected a lot of those data points. This is just the faces, and it looks like dirty dots, but if you zoom in, and I do this just by zooming, you see the actual faces, which is all by itself really nice, because you can see all the faces that people drew, I don't know, what's the past tense? Drew, thank you. But this is not enough, right? I mean, you can do much more, and what you can do is you can group them in a pivotal style, like you pivot a little bit, and you can group it by number of strokes. Like how many strokes did the people do? And this is like 1 to 10 in the bottom here, so not that many. And this is 11 to 20 and so on. And some people actually managed to have like 90 strokes in 10 minutes. I have no idea how that is possible, but like lines, 90 in 1 minute, really good. But now, maybe you also want to know something else. I don't have a question right now, but you might have one. And maybe the question is which of them has been actually recognized as a face? And I encode this in color, because this thing here now says color. And now it might be interesting. So I think the first thing you see, the more strokes, the worse the recognition, right? It's anecdotic knowledge. It's not like statistic knowledge, but it gives me the impression that's to be expected, right? And then, if you still want to know more, you can like zoom in, and you see like these faces, actually quite good, but they were like too good. Like the red ones, they weren't recognized, the blue ones, yes. And they are really artistic, I have to say. They're all really good. Well, not this one, maybe here. This would be my drawing. But but that's interesting, but it's, the point being, it's a really nice way to interactively dive through a data set and then get some intuition for it. And what we can also do, because we just have used one dimension so far, we could like group it again in a second dimension by country. That might tell you something, like where are the most drawings come from. This right one here is US. But this one here is Great Britain. So the second largest part. And it might also be interesting by, like, if you dig into it a little bit deeper and then maybe reduce or increase the number of countries, it might also be interesting to, like, find out how do people draw faces in France? I have no idea. This thing here is France. Well, not interesting. like in Germany, I would say, but I expected something special. Like, this is Great Britain. Nothing too special. Well, at least I know, okay, nothing too special. And then maybe we need to look at more strokes here, up there. This is again Great Britain. Well, well, this is how you people draw like faces. Did you know that? I did not. But at least, as I said, point being, you can dive into it. And this is just a given data set, but I also did it with a flight data set, and you can do the same thing. And for the flight data set, if you had any idea what was in it, it might even be much, much more interesting. Oh, my time. Yeah, I see it. The last one, so I might be able to make it in time, is something that you may not even have considered. It might not be the most obvious thing, but given that you have already trained a model, you have it. It's a good one. You trained it. Now, it might be that you want to deploy it. Well, obviously, yes. Typical thing would be like you have your own server, or you put down, upload it on Amazon somewhere, or on Azure, or on Google. But you also might want to have it locally in the browser, your pre-trained model. What might be reasons for that? Why would you do that? Have your model deployed in the browser? Why? Yes, sure. You distribute like the workload to the browsers. And then there's also maybe privacy. Maybe people don't want to send something over the internet. And then for most people, that's admitted, loading it into a browser, including myself, as it seems, feels like loading it up to the internet. But it actually was not. So also the training that I did here went locally. So that might be a thing. Or, as I said a little bit earlier, you want to combine the features of the model with the features of the browser, like all the interactive things. Did you know, like, the typical browser also knows, like, the tilt and the jaw and the roll of your laptop? It does. I had to find out this the hard way, but it also works. And you may come up with examples of the usage of such a model that I can't, like, envision now. So I think the potential is really big, especially if you also use the camera. You could also do something like, if you want to train your own, like, self-driving car, you just upload it in the browser, put the camera into your windscreen, and it tells you what to do. Maybe you don't obey every time. maybe there's still a sane check, but it's possible. And without any like fancy installation. And it still should run on the GPU, if it's at all possible. So if that was a motivating part, then you might also ask yourself, is it at all possible to do this in the browser? And of course, the answer is yes, otherwise I wouldn't have told you about this. It also works like on a mobile phone. Mobile phone is astonishingly powerful, but the thing with a mobile phone is you can't use its CPU or GPU power for long because it overheats very fast. But anyway. Okay, I also saw this in a browser-based game. So they are very powerful, and then you might want to have some AI, and then you don't want to train it or program it in the browser, and you program it somewhere else. So first thing. This is called Keras.js, and as you may like guess, it's using the GPU, again, like deep learn, and you can just load Keras models. So you have trained your Keras model, you save it, you upload it. Only problem might be Keras models might be 100 megabyte, 500 megabytes, and you not only need to upload it, you also need to have it in browser memory. But it works. So for all the models that I tried, it works. And I will give you the final demo in a minute. So this one, good. Next one, TensorFire, it's also GPU-based, and it cannot only load Keras, but also TensorFlow models. So if you just pure TensorFlow model, also works. At least that's what I say. Keras.js I tried out. This one, I just played with the demos. And this is one of the demo, like, how was it called? What's that called? Where you like transfer the style? Style transfer? Yeah? Really? Easy. Okay. I don't know. I think maybe it's that Japanese thing with the wave. I don't remember. And I put it on the kittens fighting. It's at least good for an example. And as I said, it at least they advertise that it can run both Keras and TensorFlow models. And like the remodel, like the HDF5 or something. Not something like pre-processed. It's really pretty cool. And I think this brings us to the last demo, but I think I showed this demo yesterday because I was desperate. So I'm going to show you another demo today. And I needed to preload this one because this actually loads 100 megabyte of model and waits into the browser before it even starts. And I'm showing you this demo because this is not at all like toy. This is the real ResNet, ImageNet trained model from Keras. So I think this is the most powerful, at least one of the two most powerful models that you can actually download for Keras, and it does image classification. And it's slow, but I used it on Bonkers, the cat of my friend here. And I think it's an Egyptian cat, but it's actually a Bengal cat, but I don't know. It works. So this is a ResNet. I can choose another one here, like the dog, to give you an impression of the speed. It's slow. But it's slow because it's really a huge thing, and this thing is not very powerful. So this might be a model that you wouldn't use. Now it knows it's a Newfoundland, I don't know, dog. But is it? I don't know. It's a dog. So, and the other also, I think this is the most, my favorite model is the Inception version 3 model. Like the real, the hot stuff, also from Google, and it runs in that browser. Maybe I'm, now that I showed you that thing, I'm reloading it now to give you an impression how long it would load, how long it would take to load that model using this Wi-Fi. Probably no one else can use the Wi-Fi now because I'm downloading 100 megabyte, 72%, and they're cheating here. I mean, they started with 65 or something. This will take forever, I guess. So to be honest, that is not maybe not such a good use case for production. I don't know. Put it somewhere in local storage in your browser. But then again, 100 megabyte is big. But also, Keras has some models that are tweaked for small size. I think they're called MobileNet or something. They're also quite good. And they're very small, so you could use them. It doesn't finish. 88. Well, at least you see it wouldn't be anything that you would want to wait for. At least I wouldn't. So, still, you can deploy that. Oh, wrong presentation? Yeah. So wrapping it up, if you actually consider browser-based applications, why would you do that? First of all, you can make of GPU use of GPU. I'm yet to show like how fast it is on a browser GPU because it has to use WebGL as an intermediate step. This thing is slow, but it's faster on GPU than on CPU. I don't know. I need more experiments. You have very high reach. So installation is basically, you have it somewhere on the web server, people click on it, they have it. Integration into existing web apps or something that you want to write, like the training demo that I spoiled, like that I messed up, where we combined it with a video camera, quite nice. Best visualizations, like very interactive, like very smooth. And also, again, with zero installation. And I think every time I want to do something interactively, learn something interactively, I do it in the browser. That was my sales pitch.